Hi, I'm Derek Hilton, and my channel is all about photographing and filming wildlife. Now, what have I got in store for you today? Let's take a look.
Well, hi, and welcome to my office. Today's subject, the UX-180. Why the UX-180 and not the X1 to save some money? Well, in Australia, there's not a big difference in price at the minute. It's just under $200 difference. But I thought, might as well, let's just pay the extra. That'll enable me to do SDI out to an external recorder, something like a Shagan, something like that. We can get 10-bit 422 color space. So I thought it was worth it. Maybe in the future I'll have something like that. Now we'll be comparing this camera to the XF300, that's Canon's camcorder that I've been using for the last 3 years. Big change from one company to another. Huge change. That's what I've been used to. All Canon products for the last 5 years. 5D Mark II DSLR and the 7D Mark II. Yeah, I'm just used to Canon stuff. It's ingrained in my brain how they work. So going to another company, huge jump, especially Panasonic. Totally different way of thinking about how a camera should work. It turns up on my doorstep. I rip the box open, pull it out. Man, is it light. This is 2 kilos. The XF300 is a bit over 3 kilos. A lot about this camera was just small, lightweight in my hand. It felt like a toy for a little while, but I know inside it's big. 1-inch sensor, all the other things that the XF300 doesn't have, and it's the reason why I bought it. XF300 doesn't have 50 frames per second and slow motion infrared. So I was very limited what I could do on the XF300. 25 frames per second. Yeah, my subject calls for a lot bigger frame. Alright, so it's in my hand, I'm playing with it. Here's this alien that's turned up on my doorstep. First thing I do, pull out the LCD screen. From the pamphlet, reading it online, desperately trying to find out more about this camera. It says 3.5-inch monitor. LCD screen. Well, it's tiny. The fonts are really small and light. It's so hard to see them in normal light. The XF300 has a 4.5-inch screen. So it's a big difference in size coming down. So that's disappointing. But at the back, our OLED screen is bloody huge when you look in there. The XF300 has a tiny one, so it's in reverse for me. So it's tiny, it's 2 inches shorter than the XF300. It's about 1 inch and a bit shorter in height. The width's a little bit smaller as well. So the XF300 feels like a monster now compared to this. But hey, this is going to help me out doing long hikes and stuff like that. A lot lighter, a lot better in those areas. Love that. Boy, does that save some time with packing up and getting started as well. Also with the cap on the XF300, it was always that worry of scratching because you go like that, fit it on as I'm going home or even taking it off. So I've always wanted one of them, and it's yeah, just to protect that lens. It's awesome. Quick, easy pack-up time. Right, so I pull out the manual, start reading it, and have a look at the inner workings of the camera. Get into the guts of it, find out how it does slow motion, and all the other things. Well, I came to the bit that talks about connecting the camera to a computer. That's when I realised there's no connector in the box. But, lucky for me, it has the same connection is the 7D Mark II. So lucky there. Whew, wipe the brow. Bit of a hairy moment there for a minute. Thought I'd have to spend more money going find one for starters. But anyway, I move on, and I also realized, where's the software? There's no CD in the box. There's nothing in the manual to tell me what I can use for this camera. So I jumped on the Panasonic site, mucked around for ages trying to find something that would suit this camera. All I could come up with is a program called P2. Doesn't say anything about this camera in it, I guess because this is so new, haven't included it on it. But anyway, I downloaded it, free program, mucked around for quite a few hours. Couldn't get it to accept this camera downloading, but I do have to say that the XF300's program that did come with the camera, so I knew that it was the right thing, was the same. Pain in the ass, took me ages to work that one out as well. So what I've done is left it for now, because we can play movie mode on a lot of different programs anyway. Windows has their video player, and I'm using that at the minute. That's fine and okay. And I can actually name each individual clip with the XF300. If I did that on the other program, it wouldn't accept them. It was a pain in the ass. But doing it that way, if that's what I'm going to have to do, be fine. Only thing is, can't see what settings I used, so metadata, I can't see it. Unless I put it into Premiere Pro, you can see a little bit, not all of it. So if there's something that I had the camera had a play and I was setting up with like a scene file or something, and can't remember what I had, I'm not going to be able to see that. But okay, so for now, I've left that program. A lot of learning to do with this camera. So that's what we're going to do now. Nick off and start doing some testing. Well, I've got myself all set up, ready to go, to test out this camera in the environment that I always film in the forest, with my subject, which is the Agile Antechinus, little carnivorous marsupial that's my passion. So what better to test the camera out on than what I usually film with? We'll be testing out the autofocus. See how good it is. The XF300 wasn't all that good. Couldn't rely on it at all. Hopefully this will be a lot better. But I don't use autofocus very often anyway. You just can't rely on it. I might have been waiting for a bit of footage for years. The opportunity comes along, have to use manual to make sure that I have control and I get it right. Then I'll move on to a bit of slow motion. See how good that is and how the focusing actually in autofocus, how that will keep up with the subject. Then I'll be moving on as the light starts to drop down, putting on a little bit of gain, be 6 dBs for starters, and then to 12. See if we get any noise or not. Might move on a little bit higher up as well, see how that goes. Then as it starts to get past twilight, I'll put the infrared filter on. I don't have an infrared light just yet. I'll be selling the 5D Mark II, hopefully this week. Fingers crossed that the person that's interested in it buys it. That'd be fantastic. I can get some batteries and all the other bits and pieces that go with it. That light would be fantastic. And hopefully it's a nice clean image when I'm up close like this. I'm 2.5 meters away from my subject. That's how I normally film. They'll be coming out very soon. All right, so I've decided to give this camera a nickname, and that is ET, because it's an alien. Man, it's really hard changing from one company to another. I'm struggling a fair bit, but I have started to get used to a fair bit of the functionality, slowly working my way around. And it's why I'm not going to be doing tons of testing tonight. Well, that's enough now. I'm going to wait for my subject to come out, film it all, see how I go, what it's like on the computer, and then I'll get back to you with my results.
Well, the autofocus is pretty good on a solid object. Also get some beautiful bokeh in the background. Well, I'm getting some very soft focus, which I'm not real happy about. Having my subject framed up close, the tracking works really well. It's fast and accurate. When we pull back, the autofocus starts to struggle, dropping off to the background. Going into Mani Mode, the tools work really well. Focus peaking, quite easy to see on the LCD screen. One of the autofocus tools that comes with this camera is a focus square we can move around with our finger. We can't drag it around, we have to tap. So wherever the subject is, we tap it and move it across the scene. And I'm loving it, it's fun. And it's a hell of a lot more accurate than standard focusing. It doesn't drop off to the background. And here's a demonstration. I'm on my subject, then I'm onto the background. And back to my subject. It's snappy. It works really well. Pulled back up close. Loving it. Slow motion. The AF, yeah, it's struggling. Struggling a lot. It's not bad on the tree trunk. But once it gets down with background distractions and stuff, it's the same. It just can't cope. There's also quite a few artifacts with autofocusing as well. Also with slow motion, I'm getting a really bad soft focus on everything. It doesn't look nice. My subject actually looks like it's been dipped in water. Something interesting happened as my subject went to run off. The autofocus locked onto it, just momentarily. Moving on to gain in reasonable lighting conditions. This is a gain of 6 dB, which is quite nice and clean. Then 12 dB, which I can see just a touch of noise, but it's okay. Moving on to bad light. So as the camera starts to struggle, you can see a lot of noise. I put on 6 dB. That dropped off the noise a little bit, but there is some there. Going on to 12 dB, we can start to see quite a bit of noise. Using super gain is super noisy, something I'll never use. This is twilight, so the camera's really struggling here. This is how I'm seeing it. Then we move on to the infrared filter. So that looks really nice, just on twilight. But as we move further into the sun setting, so I can only just see, this is what we get. Well, I've come down to the beach to test out the camera with colours. What it's like with blue skies, puffy white clouds, grey clouds, a little bit of colour in them as well. And also testing out the time lapse, so interval shooting. I'll also be diving in deep into the scene files, Canon call them picture styles. And that's to do with colour saturation, sharpening, all those sort of things. I've put the camera into sparkle with one of the scene files. Seems to be all right. Now this will give me a really good idea about making my own picture style scene file, looking at the settings of sparkle, because that's a lot more saturated than the other styles that are in there. And I can get a better idea of having my own style so that I have the camera set up to the way I want it. Diving in deep into master pedestal, all those sort of things. So yeah, let's get on with a bit of testing. Panasonic have been a little arrogant in this area. They've given me 1 minute, 10 seconds, 30 seconds, 1 minute, 2 minutes, and that is it. So just very arrogant, not giving us variable intervals. The Canon XF300, that's all it has, is from 1 second right up to 10 minutes. Clearly, it's the winner over this. And the reason why I'm a little pissed off with Panasonic not giving me those variable intervals, that's why I put on the XF300 as a comparison. Sometimes the clouds move too fast and it doesn't look all that nice. I would have loved to have had those two clips down to 8 seconds like I had with the XF300. It just helps to slow the clouds down, so it's a much more pleasurable image to watch. Also, when we have birds flying past, you get them in the scene a little bit longer. There was tons of birds in my second clip, in both of them I think, flying in and out, but you get a whoop, 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 and it doesn't look good. Let me do that, knock on the camera. Well, I've had a play with slow motion again, and I've put it onto Spark with my scene file, and that helped out a little bit. It's a little bit more sharper, but it still looks like my subject's been dipped in water. Doesn't look nice. So then I tried my own scene file. I've tweaked up the master detail, so that's the sharpness, right up to 10, where Sparkle was 6. And I'm getting a little bit more of an outline, a little bit more of the fur coming into focus, so it's a little bit better as well. Dynamic range, how does this camera perform in that area? Well, this clip demonstrates it really well. I've got very harsh light, so it's full sunlight filtering through lots of shaded areas. So I've put on the first ND filter, which is 1/4, just to help out. Well, I came home a bit late one night. It was a bit dark, always a heckler in the forest. And I come across a tawny frogmouth. All I had with me was my headlamp, which is fairly powerful. It's not something you would normally use to film wildlife, but hey, I threw it on it, and man, it worked really well. I didn't have any gain on the camera or anything, and the image looks really good. So I'll be doing a lot more exploring with my own LED lights that I use for night filming. See what it's like. I'm thinking it's going to be really good. I'm testing out the infrared capabilities without an infrared light on in Ultra HD. What's the sound like on the UX-180? Well, it's pretty good. Comparing it with the XF300, they're pretty close to each other. Very clean and natural sounds. Here's a clip that demonstrates it really well. Now, I have the shotgun microphone on, about 2 meters away from the camera, up close to my subject. You can hear the trees up high, the wind's blowing on it quite strongly. So it's a pleasant sound. That wasp sounds really nice, buzzing around the place too. So yep, sound quality, liking it so far. Well, I've had ET for about 3 weeks now, and we're getting along just fine. I'm understanding its ins and outs really well now. And I recommend that you download the owner's manual from the website. Just the one that comes with the camera is tiny, really hard to read. So putting on the computer, we can enlarge it and it looks a lot better. It's easy to read. Also recommend that you download the handbook, because that covers things that the owner's manual just doesn't cover, like how to use the scene files. Yeah, there's lots of other bits and pieces in there, but it's well worth downloading. Get a good understanding of the guts of this camera. Well, what don't I like about this camera? That tiny little monitor. It is so small. But I knew about that before I bought the camera. But what I didn't know about was how small the fonts were. Really hard to see them. Have to go for the OLED at the back just to check, make sure that things are okay, that none of my settings have changed. I always had a backup plan for that monitor anyway, because we can wirelessly control this camera by a little USB thing that fits on the top here. Buy an iPad, download the app, control it from a distance or whatever. So I always had that in mind. But in this day and age, why such a small monitor? You know, everyone's screaming, give us bigger. Why, Panasonic, haven't you put good intervals in this camera for time lapse? And the reason why I got so pissed off and said that they were arrogant, it's almost like they're saying, bad luck, mate, that's all you're getting. But such a simple thing to have in a camera, wouldn't cost that much extra money. Bit of extra time, bit of love in the camera would have been great. If you've done time-lapse before, you know that, like me, practicing and mucking around with time-lapse, you need those extra intervals. Anyway, time to move on and forget about that. I'm not happy with the slow motion. The slow motion itself is fine, but the detail in the image has just gone off the fur and it looks horrible. I'm trying to rectify that. Keep playing, hopefully, fingers crossed, I can get it to somewhere where I'll be happy with. In 1080p, we get that bit of soft focus as well. Going into Spark with my scene files has helped a lot. There's a lot more detail in that, but the first, nowhere near as good as what I get on the XF300. That is just true to life, beautiful detail of the fur, and here's a clip to show that. Now that is the same detail, or close to the same detail, that I'm getting out of Ultra HD out of this camera. Now, I don't understand that. That's a bigger sensor. Full HD should be better on this than it is on that camera. That does have 3 half-inch sensors in it, the XF300. Yeah. I'm not quite understanding that one, but anyway, time to move on with what I like about the camera. Touchscreen is awesome. It really is, and this camera does it really well. It's tap. We don't scroll and flick like we do on a mobile phone. It's almost as fast as a mobile phone. Just be patient, just tap, 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 move yourself around. I'm set up like this, ready to go. My subject's coming, I can see it in the distance. I notice that one of my settings is wrong. I can quickly go into the menu, find what I'm after, if I can remember where it was, and get out of there quick and be ready before it comes. So that's a great feature, loving it. We also get that finger focusing, what I call finger focusing, loving that. That's a great thing to have on here. It's the same thing though, tap, it's all about tap. This camera. The thing that's got me most excited about this camera is infrared. It is such a beautiful image to watch. So clean, so crisp. And that was without an infrared light. And I'm just so itching to get one. Yeah, I just can't wait. It's not just the mozzies that are making me itch. I really want one. It's going to unlock a huge door for me with studying the Agile Antechinus. I'll be able to see what they do in the dark without disturbing them. Normally I'm using an LED light. They just don't like it that much. It takes them ages to get used to it, and I'm not getting natural behavior. It's one of the reasons I bought the camera for, slow motion and infrared. At the minute, it's still helping me out a lot without a light. Like now, getting to that point now where the cameras, both of them, are going to start to struggle. Flick over the filter, infrared, and I can keep going for another, close to another hour. It's just fantastic. I'm loving it. We can use whatever resolution we like. We're not limited in that area. Just have to set it, everything up before you flick the filter over. Once you've done that, it'll tell you everything's invalid as you're pressing buttons. You have to flick it off again, set it up again, and off we go. Loving this new camera with the infrared. Can't wait for the light. It's time for me to stop talking and go home and let you ponder on the thought of whether you like this camera or not. I'll do another video in a couple of months' time once I've got the light and test it all out, and we'll see how that goes. If you'd like to subscribe, click on the subscription button down below and you'll get notification whenever I do anything else, like testing infrared. And if you'd like to go and have a look at all the things I've been doing over the years, like flash photography, birds in flight, the list goes on and on, reviews on other things, click on my icon down below. Take it to my channel. There's over 50 different videos to choose from. There must be something there of interest to you. Now just remember, if you don't do, you don't get. So get out there and start photographing and filming wildlife, which is exactly what me and ET are about to do now. See ya. Manual autofocus. I'm so involved with my speech for the ending of this video that I left ET at home to ring up my wife and get to run down here with it. Thanks, Dip.